We just leave Melllvar trapped here?
Now that you can talk to it?
Yeah.
And you just say, okay, how can we help you? Because this alien has feelings or, you know, desires. And
right. And what if he really wasn't malevolent? What if he was just taking drastic measures in desperation?
To survive.
Which is such a relatable thing.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps I could use this as an excuse to go to those far-off planets with little polka dotted people if necessary, and be able to talk about love, war, nature, God, sex, all those things that go to make up the excitement of the human condition.
I'm Captain James Kirk.
Captain Kirk!
Kirk of the Starship Enterprise.
And the ineluctable Mr. Spock.
Mr. Spock, my first officer.
Captain Dr. Spock in love?
I can't imagine.
Kirk of the Starship Enterprise.
Did I ever tell you about the time I saved Captain Kirk's life?
Kirk of the Starship Enterprise.
What a blessing to be able to live one's life over again. If the life you've led has left you unfulfilled.
Jolan True, and welcome to Humanist Trek. It's a Star Trek podcast about the humanism in Star Trek. I'm Sarah Ray.
And I'm Allie Ashmead.
And welcome to the animated series.
Woohoo! We're here.
I guess this is the appropriate time to announce that Jimmy Doohan will be providing the voices of Sarah and Allie for the rest of this.
I know. No, Majel's going to provide mine.
Okay, right.
Because, you know.
I'm excited to start our journey through the animated series. This is going to be fun.
Yeah, I think so, too. It's bittersweet because we got so used to TOS and now we're in TAS. And
yeah,
it's different, but I'm loving it.
Yeah. We also want to tell you that this weekend we will be at Retromania in Aurora, Colorado at the Arapaho County Fairgrounds. So if you're in the area, you should totally come out and see us. You can also meet Land of the Lost Legends, Sid Croft, Wesley Ewer, and Kathy Coleman.
That's going to be so cool. And it's so fitting that I'm going to be wearing a Gorn shirt.
It's going to be nice because we will now have our photo having been taken with R2-D2. And now mm-hmm. we'll have us with a Slee Stack. So mm-hmm. we're just like, we're going around pollinating all of the other sci-fi franchises.
Heck yeah.
I love it. So that's this weekend, May 18th to 19th at the Arapahoe County Fairgrounds in Aurora. Come on out and see us. It's going to be a good time. I have to get all of our shit packed up because I haven't done that yet. So I guess that's what I'm doing the rest of today. So we'll have our merch with us. I have not ordered any like stock of the newer shirt designs that we've made. Mm-hmm. So I don't have like a full selection. The more shirts we design, there's no way we can inventory that stuff.
With
the kind of money that we actually make, there's no reason to sit on that kind of inventory. Anyway, we'll have some of our merchandise. We'll have our little lapel pins, magnety lapel pins with the little Humanist Trek logo. And our shirts and some stickers and all of that good stuff. Come talk Star Trek with us. Take pictures. It's going to be a good time.
Yeah. Can I just say that, one, I am enjoying the shorter episodes.
Yeah.
But two, the shorter episodes make them get right to the fucking point. And I am enjoying this immensely. And it's just all about the story, and I'm just enjoying the heck out of this for some reason.
There's not even a cold open.
No, not really.
No, it's just right into it. All right, well, let's get into it. It's Star Trek, the animated series, season one, episode one, Beyond the Farthest Star.
Sir, contact with an object. It's moving toward us.
No visual contact yet.
Reflectors, full intensity.
Pursue.
Yes, Captain. Anything on your scanners?
It's coming at light speed.
Collision course. Visual contact.
Anything, over.
All wavelengths dominated by ionization effects, sir.
All engines full stop.
Before we get into the episode, what did you make of the animated series opening credits theme?
Actually, I liked it.
Yeah.
I liked it. I like all of the music, actually. They seem to play a lot of background music, like, constantly.
Yeah.
Actually, don't mind it at all.
The theme of this series was very, like, very 1973 to me. It's like Boston Pops Orchestra does the Love Boat theme, was kind of the vibe I got from this music.
Yeah, it's not as Star Trek-y as the other themes.
Right. I'd have to listen again, but it doesn't even have the fanfare, does it?
Not really.
Doesn't have that at all. I don't think.
It's the orchestra. I don't remember now.
We do get the classic Shatner 5-year mission space to Final Frontier bit. So that was good. That was a consistency. The Enterprise is beyond the edge of our galaxy doing some routine star charting mission. Did they have to go through the barrier? Wasn't that a big, like...
They're still in the galaxy. Like, if they were going out, they're on the edges of our galaxy, but they're but they haven't left it.
Isn't where that thing is that they had to go through in that one episode with the LSD eyes? What's his name? Gary Mitchell?
Yeah. 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 The galactic barrier is when you go past it into another galaxy or out of galaxy. So they're just at the galactic barrier.
Okay. The place that they're approaching is called Questar M17, which is a source of mysterious radio emissions. But that's the last time you'll ever hear that name, period.
Questar M17?
They don't mention it again in this episode, not once. Smash cut to red alert on the bridge, where now the Enterprise is out of control.
The Enterprise is suddenly experiencing what Spock explains as a severe hypergravitational effect. And basically, they're being pulled toward this Questar M17. They have no control over their systems. Scotty's done all he can. He's cut the power. And they're still being pulled in, and they're picking up speed.
We didn't have the power. There's a ship shake when they try reversing power, and I was disappointed we didn't get to see the bridge crew do the jerk.
Well, they're cartoons. They
just kind of shook the animation cells a little bit.
Yeah.
We get a fun shot of the sonar screen between Chekhov and Sulu, and you kind of watch as the little green dot moves closer and closer to this large orange dot.
Yeah, and honestly, I didn't mind the graphics. I mean, they're actually better than the actual show when you think about it, some of the effects.
On screen, there's a dead sun straight ahead, and it's definitely the source of this radiation. And Uhura puts this crackly radiation sound on the speakers, but all of Spock's readings are negative on this object.
Which I didn't understand that at all. So he said it's a negative star mass.
How does it have negative mass?
I don't know. I googled it. I googled.
Okay.
You said all the readings are negative, but I still don't understand what it means. I may have Stefan may ask Stefan to explain this to me.
This led me to believe that the solution to all of our problems this episode was going to be a reverse the polarity thing.
Well, sort of.
Because we're talking about negative. Negative and positive.
Isn't right.
Yeah. So they're being pulled toward this dead sun, 90 some seconds to go before they'll impact into it. And Sulu throws the Enterprise into first gear and pops the clutch just in time to slip
to
the ship into orbit. Yeah.
Right. And so I just thought it was a little bit funny because Spock is, they say, okay, you got 93 seconds. And Spock does the counting. That's Sulu's job.
Yep.
But so they did do the opposite. Instead of trying to go in reverse, they went forward, and that just sort of, I guess, negated what the planet or whatever it was going to do. I don't know.
Yeah. There's a lot of minutiae here that just didn't connect for me. So we're orbiting this dead sun, right, which has some kind of massive gravity pull, and they have the whole conversation about how difficult it might be to break out of orbit. But then suddenly... Now there's some other object out there and
just floating. Yeah.
And they just change course to go up alongside it. I thought it was going to be hard to maneuver or whatever. And I actually wrote in my notes here in your voice, it's a cartoon, Sarah. It's just a cartoon.
stop taking this so seriously. Yeah. It's a cartoon and it's also sci-fi. Right. They can do whatever they want.
Yeah. Now, Bones refers to this thing as a starship, but it looks like Sulu had a botany experiment go terribly wrong after buying a plant after a total eclipse of the sun. It's a Little Shop of Horrors.
Oh.
Crickets. You missed that one.
Yeah, sorry.
I was convinced this thing was organic.
It looked like a jellyfish. With the like round pods connected by strings or whatever, and it was wobbly looking, and it looked not like a machine, but like you said, something organic.
Yeah.
But somehow McCoy pulls that out of his ass that hey, this is a starship.
Anyway, we get a lot of exposition from Spock here. This alien ship has taken damage, probably from being pulled in like we were, and those readings Uhura's been tracking are coming from it, except that the ship is lifeless. Temperature is at absolute zero, no evidence of anything that could support life. Wait, are we going to recalibrate the scanners and find a new type of life form that doesn't register on our scans?
Did they think of that?
Right?
Yeah. They always say no signs of life as they know it, like carbon life.
Yeah.
He's getting a slight magnetic flux, which could be normal for this ship's metal. And this metal is an unknown alloy, harder and lighter than any registered metal. And this particular ship is not of any galactic starship design that they know of. But then somehow he's able to date this ship, and it possibly has been orbiting here for 300 million years.
Allie, what's the best way to learn about a 300 million year old civilization's abandoned car? Board it.
Get in it, huh?
Yeah, get in it. So KSM plus Scotty head down to the transporter room, where Kyle stands by, ready to beam them down. Kyle's here.
Kyle. But it's actually Jimmy doing it.
Yeah. Yeah, this was the point that I took a research diversion and learned that Jimmy Doohan did like 328 individual voices for various characters in this episode alone.
Oh yeah, and then also Majel Barrett was also
a bunch of different voices.
Her voice
too.
Plus any of the extra female, and then Uhura did like a couple. Michelle Nichols did some alien voices too. So they're in the transporter room, and as they're just about to beam away, Kirk says, "Activate the life support belts."
We got to talk about these.
Yes, hell yeah! I'm like, dude, this is genius. Like, this is. I wonder why they didn't keep this idea, because it did. It was introduced in one of the episodes in TOS, but then they didn't keep doing it.
I don't even remember that.
I think it was the Tholian web, from what I read.
I was going to ask if these belts were the genesis of the belts that they had in the Star Trek, the motion picture.
A movie?
Yeah.
It could have been. Because, well, so I did read this life support belt was exclusively TAS.
Okay.
So maybe.
I kind of miss the old tablecloth spacesuits with the dumb helmets.
But this is what I think. This life support belt was really cool, and they could actually visually, because it's a cartoon, show that this. So these belts give you a force field all around their body and basically maintains their air and temperature and everything so that they can pretty much just wear a belt and that's it.
Yeah.
And then the cartoon, you're able to see the little glow around them.
More exposition. Their closer observation leads to thinking maybe this is some kind of insectoid species because of the hexagonal shapes like earth bees make, you know? And so, of course, it has to be insect because it couldn't possibly be anything else. And the metal isn't like a forged alloy or whatever either. It's spun like a spider web. And each of these pods looks like it's been busted open from the inside. And I was screaming at my TV right now. Red alert, beam us up.
Get the fuck out of here.
Go to the next adventure. Fuck yeah, get me out of here.
We've seen this movie. This is Alien or some shit like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, this is like big egg sacks, and God knows where the babies are. If the, or, over like, well, 300 million years, they could have grown to swollen to massive numbers.
And McCoy's like, it's saying what we're all thinking. It must have been pretty awful to for them to maybe possibly destroy their own ship.
Yeah.
Boy, that was quick.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because we get right to the fucking point.
Yeah, these episodes do not fuck around.
No.
After the break, Kirk calls up Uhura and learns that whatever this alien ship was transmitting before stopped suddenly after they beamed over.
That's a red flag.
So now the plan is to keep a transporter lock on the away team because they're going into the ship. The inside of this thing is even more organic looking to me.
It looks like mushrooms growing. There's like a some sort of plant thing with tentacles that is growing. Yeah. And yeah, it's very organic. It's what's that show? Did you watch Farscape?
No.
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 it's a Leviathan from Farscape.
Okay.
Anyway.
Spock's getting some energy readings now. Apparently, this ship was designed specifically to receive and store energy. And McCoy and Scotty are both squicked out by this whole situation. They both feel like they're being watched. And if Scooby-Doo taught us anything, they're probably right. But Spock just kind of waves this away as it's a silly evolutionary holdover in the Homo sapiens, you know, back when your species was primitive. Well, more primitive than you are now. And, you know, back when you didn't know where the sun went at night and you made up lots of gods to explain.
Earth is flat and all that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Kirk's like, yeah, whatever. Let's just keep going. They go through a hexagonal sliding door and Spock has to shoot it to get it open.
Without question, without discussion, they walk up to this door. Spock whips out his heater and lights it up.
I'm surprised they didn't. Hey, check that control panel and see if you can rewire it or something.
No, Allie, yeah, it's the animated series. We ain't got time for that.
Well, that's right. That would take forever.
Yeah.
Anyway, so they walk into something that looks sort of like an engineering, like all kinds of machinery. And as soon as they walk through, the fucking door slams behind them.
This is some more Scooby-Doo shit.
Everything starts waking up and moving around from a dead ship.
They talk about how there's artificial atmosphere and gravity in this room. But did you notice when they came in? This is my problem with the life support belts. When they came in, their life support belts were on and you saw the glow around them. Mm-hmm. And then the door shuts behind them. And apparently they turn off automatically. So I need to understand, is this lane assist, right? Is this like, oh, the atmosphere suddenly dropped, and so my belt comes on automatically to protect me? And then does it turn itself off automatically when it detects a safe atmosphere outside?
Oh, that's a good point. And maybe it does.
And do I trust that automated technology to keep me in the lane and not driving into oncoming traffic? No.
No,
I don't.
It's going to malfunction at some point.
Yeah. For sure.
And you're going to be too dead to sue or anything.
Scotty's got a plan to just blast a hole in the wall with his heater. They're all ready to just shoot shit. But interestingly, all their weapons have been drained of power. One more red flag on the mountain of red flags.
Of course. And they cannot communicate with the Enterprise anymore.
Mm-hmm. So they have a better look around this control room and they find a console that doesn't seem to belong. And that is the source of the interference. Spock thinks the crew jury-rigged some shit up here during an emergency. And Scotty adds that it's some kind of shielding for this room. But shielding from what or whom?
And it's whatever came on aboard the ship 300 million years ago.
Yeah, and right on cue, the door that they came through starts glowing and buzzing and something is clearly trying to get in from the other side.
Yeah.
there's some weird muffled voice playing in the audio track from somewhere. And then on a hexagonal view screen appears another character voiced by Jimmy Doohan.
And this time it's an alien, and it does look kind of insectoid, sort of.
Mm-hmm.
And they can't understand it at first, but Spock does some magic on the console, and he's able to clear it up. And then we hear actually what they're saying.
Danger! Danger, Will Robinson!
Get the fuck off the ship! Too late, though. Yeah.
Yeah.
So this alien is like, it sounds like their speech has been like slowed down. And it's like, danger, danger, the dead star, we are being drawn to it. Rather than carry this malevolent life form to other worlds, we have decided to destroy our own ship. There is no other answer. If you understand this message, it's too late. if you understand this message, you're protected only for this moment in this room. And then it starts a sentence. This thing, it wants, and then everything fucking blows up. Boom, like everything.
Apparently, this explosion has dropped whatever field was keeping them from transporting, because mm-hmm. they beam out and rematerialize on the transporter pad, along with the stowaway.
I find it funny, though, because they were all on the ground, laying on the ground or kneeling when they blew up, and then they materialize on the transporter pad standing up. I always think that's funny. I'm like, how do they do that?
Yeah.
Whatever.
I maintain that is the inconsistency, and I'm sure we've looked this up, but I wouldn't remember. I wouldn't remember if you told me yesterday that.
Oh, they did it in the show, the TOS too.
That the way the system operates is the way you're standing is the way you appear, and that they can't just move your molecules around on the transporter controls to make you stand
mm-hmm.
if you were kneeling. And so I maintain that the example we saw in this scene is the error.
Mm.
Anyway, I also have lots of questions. What the fuck happened to Kyle's voice? Did
he's now a little bit Scottish?
Did Jimmy forget what accent he was doing or what character he was doing?
Yeah, because Kyle sounds just a tiny bit Scottish.
And why didn't Kyle detect this other life form during transport before materializing? Wouldn't you think they'd be like, oh, there's something else in the stream here?
Well, also, too, they're so only supposed to lock on like however many.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be that this entity was able to just hitch a ride without Kyle doing anything.
Right.
That's the only reasonable explanation, I think, is the entity did it.
So this entity is a glowy green cloud thing. And Kirk's like, oh, fuck. Melllvar? No. No, no, no. We are not doing another Melllvar convention.
Oh, dip.
Dip indeed.
It is I.
Oh, whoa. What a cheesy effect.
I'm not an effect.
That's awesome.
Join Patreon if you want to get that joke. Kirk orders Kyle to transporter it away, but apparently he doesn't move fast enough because Kirk like leaps and knocks him over to get to the transporter controls himself.
Yeah, he's literally elbows him out of the way, but it's too late because this green smoke creature that looks like something off of Ghostbusters like goes through the vents and all into all the machinery, and then we hear this like sinister laugh.
Maniacal laugh. Maniacal laugh. Maniacal laugh. Maniacal laugh. Maniacal
laugh. After the break, the whole Enterprise has a green glow around it. And on the bridge, Kirk goes around the horn asking for status reports. Another new piece of tech, Spock says that the automatic bridge defense system is on and prepared. And we see this thing on the ceiling that reminded me of a light fixture that I had back when I did mobile DJ and stage sound and lighting stuff.
Like a disco ball.
Yeah.
Thing.
Yeah. It was like a multicolored gobo that turned and rotated. And yeah. Kirk and Scotty have a conversation about being prepared to blow up the damn ship.
No! No!
like the other ship did, just in case. And for some reason, this involves going to engineering to arm a self-destruct device there.
Do you guys have a self-destruct code, like destruct sequence 1A, 2B, 3?
Thanks a lot, Decay. Now everybody knows.
But I seem to remember in Voyager, they had to go to engineering to this table and turn a key and then to say their codes. And I don't know if they did that in TNG, too.
In TNG, that I think that happened on the bridge.
I don't know. It's weird.
Interesting.
But it's cool that they've got a bridge defense system that will keep them from bringing every fucking person onto the bridge.
Yeah, right? Where was that thing when fucking Charlie X was melting chess pieces?
Yeah.
Spock's update is that they're experiencing a slightly higher than normal magnetic flux, which you'll recall was one of the first things they saw on scanning the alien ship.
Mm-hmm.
But this magnetic flux isn't constant, and on Spock's Viewmaster, we see what looks very much like a pulse monitor in the hospital.
Well, then, and Kirk does liken it to, it's like a beating heart. But then, just then, Uhura reports that life support has started to fucking shut down on decks 5 and 6, and they've all got to use life support belts. So maybe it does automatically come on.
Yeah. I need to know. I need to know how this works.
Sarah, it's a cartoon.
I know. Spock's also got an emergency call on the red phone, trouble in engineering. And for some reason, Kirk calls down to sick bay to have Bones go to engineering. What good is he going to be there?
I guess he assumes it's a medical emergency.
Maybe animated McCoy is more useful than the real McCoy.
So they get down to engineering, and the emergency is that Scotty has somehow gotten himself trapped into the cover of the core, and there's like a hatch that's like sitting on him. Luckily, he's got his life support belt, which also gives you a force field around you, and that's what's holding the hatch from smashing him to pieces.
They're not able to override the hatch because the controls have been magnetized. So I think it's becoming more and more clear now that this alien entity we're dealing with is some kind of magnetic something or other. It's a Melllvar the Magnetic Slimer or something.
Yep. And it's making the ship go haywire.
So they go off and get a blowtorch.
Yeah. Cutter.
To try to cut through. And this is... these episodes do not have time to spare. And yet, the musical tense building that happens as they're trying to cut through this hatch spent more seconds than they had available.
I am loving this music, though. Mm-hmm. I think I'm going to, by the end of the series, I'm going to be humming it like all the time.
Yeah.
It's really good. Good danger music.
Allie loves good danger music.
I like some danger
you
music.
You do, I know. Back on the bridge, Sulu's got more problems. The phasers suddenly turned themselves on and vaporized the other ship.
I've never seen a phaser do that either.
Right.
Like shoot something and then make it disappear.
No,
like not on a not on the ship, like a phaser gun. I've seen that happen.
Yes. Right. Yeah. We've seen a hand phaser evaporate somebody, but yeah,
not a whole ship.
Scotty and McCoy come back to the bridge, unable to get the core to do the self-destruct thingy because apparently the blowtorches now have all been drained of their energy, too. More areas start losing life support, and Spock notices a correlation in the magnetic flux readings. Uhura's picked up on something going through the computer storage banks. It's taken control of the entire ship. Kirk recognizes that what happened to that other ship is likely happening here. And he asks Spock to rig up a shield on the navigation console like that alien ship had. Some more time passes and Spock's got the shield rigged up, but it only covers an area 3 meters square. We're starting off metric. We'll see how this goes. We'll see if we stick with it. Kirk has now put this week's puzzle together. The alien entity must be trapped here by the sun's massive gravity and is trying to use a ship to escape. And sure enough, from the dance party light fixture on the ceiling, we hear a voice confirming this.
I am Melllvar, seer of the tapes, knower of the episodes. Tremble before my encyclopedic knowledge of Star Trek.
The voice of Melllvar is provided by, you guessed it, James Doohan.
And he has waited so long, so terribly long, he says. It's absorbed all the memory banks, and he's ordering Captain Kirk to remove the static shield from the navigation console so he can get to it. And he's just kind of barking orders and telling them to obey me. And I swear I heard a Dalek in there.
Oh.
Because he kept saying, obey me.
Yeah.
Obey all Dalek commands. Obey instantly. Obey without question. Obey. 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 Obey.
Melllvar wants them to turn off that shield. And Kirk tries to, like, barter to get life support reestablished where Melllvar disabled it. But it sounded like Melllvar was just, maybe Melllvar was turning off non-essential systems so there would be more power to pull away from the star.
Yeah, I didn't think about that.
He kind of made, like, because he says in this scene, I turned off non-essential systems. Kirk says, you've shut down life support systems and endangered my crew. Turn them back on. And Melllvar says, all non-essential systems are extinguished. You will obey me. So I couldn't tell if that was like a malevolent move or if it was like we're turning off non-essential systems.
Well, there were people in there. So maybe this entity considers that non-essential.
That's possible.
But he's actually killing people or trying to kill people because everybody's life support belt snapped on. Kirk's like, okay, well, what if I don't? And the green alien starts shooting at Kirk. And then also Spock and saying, you better obey me. And Spock is kind of caught in the beam. And I think he's got his belt on that's keeping it from killing him. But Kirk's like, okay, stop. I'll obey. Let him go.
This was kind of a classic Spock moment here, right? Mm-hmm. Spock's getting zapped and he's like, no, Kirk, don't give in.
Don't give in.
Needs of the mini like, or whatever. Yeah.
And Kirk always does. He always does to save his friend.
Yeah. But that was a lie. Kirk goes over to the navigation console, presses a button, and then takes off his life support belt and lays it on the console. So I guess he disabled Spock's jury rig shield, and instead now his Batman utility belt is acting as the shield. I wasn't super clear on what happened.
Yeah.
Here.
I would say that was the intention, but I'm not sure how those belts function now because is it just a certain. Whatever it's in contact with, it forms a shield around it, I guess.
This didn't make a lot of sense to me either. Kirk does a forward roll, dodging a phaser beam from the disco ball thing on the ceiling. But then it just doesn't fire again?
No. And
oh,
then
you dodged
over
the first shot, so it's okay. Everything's good.
Yeah, and then he goes over and starts whispering with Spock, so it didn't stop them from plotting.
Spock describes this alien as a magnetic organism without mass, but capable of symbiotic relationship with a host body like a starship. And now it's basically taken over the whole ship like a brain in a body.
Brain and brain, what is brain?
And as Spock is explaining that if the ship is the body and Melllvar is the brain, then they are basically like white blood cells. And at this, we get kind of a push-in on McCoy as if he's realizing something, but that doesn't pay off, does it?
He didn't say anything in this episode. He's not contributed anything.
Well, that's normal. And more bad news, the magnetic flux readings are getting higher as Melllvar gets stronger.
They have got to figure out a way to slingshot out of orbit. And Kirk wants to make sure he computes it in his mind, because if you use the ship's computers, then the Melllvar, is that what we're calling him, is going to know about it.
Well, he hang on, Allie. He wants Spock to do the calculations where?
In his brain?
Brain and brain!
What is
brain?
Spock's brain. To be specific?
Yeah. So Kirk asks Melllvar for permission for Spock to help Scotty do some repairs. And there's no answer, so they assume that's a yes. And then Melllvar gives them a set of coordinates to plot, which I assumed was like, take me back to my home world.
No, but it's at the heart of their galaxy, Sulu reports. But Kirk's like, go ahead and plot the course, because in his mind, he's like, that's not really the plan.
Right.
Plot the course and placate the alien.
This whole thing quickly reveals itself as a classic unspoken Star Trek plan. They pretend to be doing repairs. They pretend to activate the warp drive controls. And as the Enterprise seems to be quickly plummeting into the star, Melllvar abandons ship, thinking that Kirk is destroying the Enterprise rather than allow Melllvar to escape this dead sun.
It abandons ship and basically surrounds this dead sun star and so we see the green glow around the planetoid. So then the alien does something or says stuff that you wouldn't normally hear from a evil alien. It's like, please, no, don't. And I'm just like, wow, feeling kind of sorry for it.
Yeah.
But it's like begging, please don't do this.
Boy, I'm sure glad that's over with.
I'm happy the affair is over.
Me too.
A most annoying, emotional episode.
Yeah, but you know, I learned something today.
When dreams become more important than reality, you give up travel, building, creating.
One jealous god, if all this makes a god.
By sparing your helpless enemy, who surely would have destroyed you, you demonstrated the advanced trait of mercy.
Frankly, I was rather dismayed by your use of the term half-breed. You must admit, it is an unsophisticated expression.
This is a classic Star Trek story, perhaps a classic sci-fi story, generally. An alien being is misunderstood to be malevolent when it's just lonely. And the discovery of this is what's classic about it, right? But I want the rest of the story. We just leave Melllvar trapped here. And again, no warning buoys to keep other ships from going through this same thing.
But also, we didn't try to, now that you can talk to it.
Yeah.
You just say, okay, how can we help you? Because they ended this episode with the green alien begging, please don't leave me alone.
Yeah.
Please, please, so lonely. And that to me was like, wow.
Right.
This alien has feelings or, you know, desires. And
right. And what if he really wasn't malevolent? What if he was just taking drastic measures in desperation
to survive?
Which is such a relatable thing.
Mm-hmm.
For humans, for us, the viewer. Like, would it really be so bad to help him escape this sun? Help him find home or others like him? No, this episode assumes the worst, and we leave Melllvar stranded.
Right. Instead of like, okay, how can we help you?
Yeah.
So he was wanting to go to the middle of the galaxy, which is where the black hole is, where there's energy. But, you know, maybe his existence is hurting other life forms because he's like absorbing like magnetic, he's like some sort of magnetic creature. But, that's the way it is.
Yeah.
He was born that way. you know what I mean?
I was born this way. I was born this way.
I'm on the right track, baby. I was born this way.
I don't know. I just thought they didn't do anything to help.
Yeah.
He was like, bah.
Yeah.
Bah, Felicia.
I don't know if, you know, I don't know if the intention was to leave us feeling this way. I get the feeling that that was the intention, you know, because this is not an episode where the triumphant Star Trek trumpets play and everything is solved and everyone is happy and off we go to the next adventure, right? This one kind of leaves on this hanging cloud that...
Like, yeah. Like, whoa, you guys just did that?
Yeah. Yeah, what
you
the
just
hell?
Left them there? Left them there begging? I'm like, wow.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And I know we see this again in TNG. I don't remember the details, but I know that we bump into... you know, the lonely alien outcast who's you're just looking for a friend or whatever. So Melllvar will be back in some form or another.
Yeah. The old Melllvar trope.
Let's get right to business.
Fine, I'm authorized to pay an equitable price.
Federation has invested a great deal of money in our training. They're about due for a small return.
Listen, we pay our percentages. We're entitled to a little service for our money, eh?
Is this the way your citizens do business? Their right of petition?
They pay their percentages and the boss takes care of them.
Is there anything else?
We need to welcome a new patron to our ranks.
No, knob? No, noob? Something?
Uh-huh.
Knob.
Uh-huh. Knob Tinker.
I love the name.
Hut.
I love it. Welcome, Knob Tinker.
Yes. Knob Tinker is an ensign. So thanks for joining our crew. And we very much appreciate you and everyone who supports us.
Well, hello there, interstellar wanderers. Guinan here, your favorite purveyor of wisdom and cosmic cocktails. Now, I've got something to tell you about a little podcast called Humanist Trek. I know. I usually deal with real-life space-time drama at 10 forward, but this one's worth a listen. You see, they're on a mission. Laughter, exploration, and all that jazz. First off, leave a review. Share the love like it's a secret ingredient in a warp core breach. Spread it around and let the galaxy know what's what. For those feeling a bit more philanthropic and just wanting to splurge some Federation credits, become a patron. It's like having a backstage pass to the holodeck, but better. Early access to episodes, exclusive merch that's cooler than a Ferengi's profit margin, and bonus content like personal logs. Imagine Spock, but funnier. Oh, and did I mention reactions to those very short treks? It's like watching Klingons try to line dance. Pure entertainment. So it's time to join the fleet. Do yourself a favor. Head over to patreon.com/humanisttrek. It's the cosmic investment in laughter and the kind of support that makes the universe a brighter place. Trust me, it means a lot to them. And hey, it might just brighten up your journey through the stars too. Cheers.
I assume you're loitering around here to learn what efficiency rating I plan to give your cadets.
Trainees, to the briefing room. Is that all you gotta say? What about my performance?
Aren't you dead?
I don't believe this was a fair test of my command abilities. There was no way to win.
There's no correct resolution. It's a test of character.
Now, what is that supposed to mean?
I am understandably curious.
May I ask you a question?
Who's been holding up the damn elevator?
Last time, on General Hospital. Isn't that the one you're watching now?
Oh, God. Such a bitch.
Are you watching General Hospital?
Oh, I've watched General Hospital my whole life, yes.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Last time on Humanist Trek, we had a question for this episode, Beyond the Farthest Star. Remind us what the question was again for Beyond the Farthest Star.
Leonard Nimoy nearly refused to join the cast of the series. Why?
And I don't remember what we said.
Sarah said he wanted more money.
Oh, yes.
Allie said maybe he was concerned about vocal parameters.
Which was totally bullshit.
Yeah, those are wrong. What's the right answer?
Well, originally, George Takei, Walter Koenig, and Nichelle Nichols were not asked to be part of the production due to budget considerations. So when Nimoy learned about this, he refused to join unless his friends were included.
Incorrect.
Awesome. Oh, I'd love him. Jeez, he's so great.
Mm-hmm.
Do we need to give you a moment of privacy, Allie?
Oh, no, I'm good. I do love him, though. Gosh. Leonard Nimoy. Just, I mean, always thinking of Nichelle and Sulu and his fellow actors.
Yeah, and why wouldn't, I don't know, the first on the call sheet, shouldn't they be the one to, you know, advocate? Where the hell was Shatner in all of this?
Do we need to answer that?
No, we don't. I'm just being facetious. Well, next time on Humanist Trek, we will be reviewing Star Trek the Animated Series, Season 1, Episode 2, Yesteryear. Spock travels back in time to prevent his death as a young Vulcan, which seems familiar to me, like we did this in New Trek.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know. What's our question for Yesteryear?
Jane Wyatt did not return to play the role of Spock's mother, Amanda Grayson, for this episode. Who voiced Amanda instead?
We've done a little research, and based on that research, I would say Majel Barrett Roddenberry, because the research we did was that there were two voice actors who pretty much did all of the voices, which was Majel and James Doohan. So I'm going to say Majel, right?
And I'm going to agree.
Yes.
Yeah.
Majel, lock it in. Final answer. And if you'd like to play along, you know how to do that. Head out to your social media. Share this episode. Use the hashtag Starfleet Challenge. We'll pick out somebody that we like best. And maybe we'll read it on the show if I remember to look for them. Next time on Humanist Trek, Star Trek, the animated series, season 1, episode 2, Yesteryear.
Diftor hech smusma.
Kapla!
Humanist Trek is available wherever you replicate your podcasts. Follow us on all the social medias at Humanist Trek. Become a patron at patreon.com/humanisttrek. Open hailing frequencies to podcast@humanisttrek.com and visit our website, humanisttrek.com. Humanist Trek is a production of Sarah Austin Media.